All right, good evening, everyone. I hope you're excited because the conference is almost over. Hope you've had a great time. It's my privilege to introduce our last and one of our best speakers of all, Mr. Steve Moore. Mr. Moore received a master's in economics from George Mason University before he actually was the research director for President Reagan's privatization committee during the 1980s. He's also served as a fellow at the Cato Institute. He's also the president of the club, was president for the Club for Growth, which helped promote free market policies in the government. He's also been a distinguished visiting fellow at the Heritage Foundation in Washington, D.C., which is the one of the most influential think tanks in all the United States of America. Mm-hmm. He's also an economic analyst on both Fox and CNN. He's consistently worked with lawmakers to try to get more pro-growth policies and to help stimulate the American economy. And he's also been an advisor of President Trump since 2016. He helped advise him on his during the 2016. Earlier this year, he was even nominated to be one of the governors of the Federal Reserve Board, but he eventually decided to withdraw his nomination. He is also a longtime YAF speaker, having worked with Young America's Foundation to be able to come to speak on campuses around the entire nation to help promote the student and to give students the tools to promote the free market. So if you guys want to host Mr. Steve Moore on your high school or college campuses, we are more than happy to work with you to make that a possibility. So will everyone please join me in giving a very warm welcome to our final speaker of the event, Mr. Steve Moore.
Thank you. Wow. Thank you. Wow. Thank you very much. That's a very nice, warm introduction, and pleasure to be here. I want to take a lot of your questions. Want to talk to you about what's going on with the economy. Thought you might have a little bit of fun. Talk a little bit about Donald Trump. Because I love the guy, you know, I love the guy. And by the way, let me just start by asking you all this. And I want your honest answer. There's be honest. There's no right or wrong answer. You're not gonna be demoted or anything like that if you answer one way or the other. But how many of you in this room would say you have a positive opinion of Donald Trump? Raise your hand. Wow, I love you guys. How many of you guys have a negative opinion? A few of you do. So. Look, I'm not here to sell you on Donald Trump, but I will tell you this, that I've worked with him now for 4 years. I worked on the campaign, and that was a really great, great time. Larry Kudlow and I were the senior economic advisors for the Trump campaign, which was, you know, an amazing, amazing campaign. Remember, everybody said, one of the lessons, by the way, if you come away from this little lecture with remembering nothing else, maybe the most important thing I can tell you is that when you think about the campaign, that in 2016, almost every political prognosticator, almost every, you know, talking head on TV, all the pollsters, all the kind of political pros, almost every one of them said that Donald Trump could not possibly win the election, right? Remember that? They said, there is no way Donald Trump is gonna win the election. It is a 1 in 50 chance, you know, and all of these, you know, outrageous things would happen before Donald Trump would ever be elected. And of course, on election night, by the way, please do not tell my wife I said this, but election night 2016 was probably the best night of my life. But on election night 2016, it was really funny. I mean, on MSNBC at 8 o'clock when the polls closed on the East Coast, Hillary Clinton's chief pollster went on TV and she said, based on the exit polling that we have seen today, we believe that Hillary Clinton has a 95% chance of winning the election. Now you know why Hillary locked herself in the bathroom and couldn't go out and give a concession speech that night. But why am I saying this? Because sometimes in life, and a lot more often than you would think, the experts, the so-called experts, are completely wrong. So when you hear people, you know, and this is important, when you get, you're in your senior year or junior year in high school, when you get into college, people will say things are absolutely certainly going to happen, right? And yet it's amazing how many times the consensus opinion is wrong. And so it pays to be skeptical. I mean, I hear people all the time say, we know with certainty that global warming is happening. They say, we know with certainty. Well, a lot of scientists say it is going to happen. A lot of scientists say it's not going to happen. But we know nothing is certain in life. And it pays to have a skeptical eye. That doesn't mean we should disregard science. You know, science is important. And if every scientist were saying such and such was going to happen, then, you know, it might be worth paying attention to. But there are a lot of people who are saying it isn't. And there are all sorts of examples of you know, throughout my lifetime, where the experts and the scientists and the, you know, the people who are supposed to know more about a subject than anyone have been wrong in their predictions. So let me talk a little, by the way, one of the things I'd say about Donald Trump is, you know, that might surprise you. How many of you, any of you in this room actually ever met Donald Trump? I see one or two have met Trump. I mean, he's a very nice guy. I really like him. He's fun to be around. He's very charming. He's fun to talk to, and is open to ideas. And you know, I always say that 90% of politicians you're going to meet in your lifetime, if any of you go in politics, you'll soon discover this, that 90% of politicians are wonderful people in public and jerks in private. You know, Trump is the opposite. He's a jerk in public and a wonderful person in private, you know, so he has a kind of opposite. But I really admire him, and I do think this is, I know that, you know, YAF is not a political organization and not a partisan organization, but I do think the stakes are pretty high here. You know, this is a really important election. How many of you paid any attention to what's going on the Democrat side? Are you guys paying attention? Well, you know, it's interesting, isn't it? Every time the Democrats have their, you know, debates like they did last Thursday and they did their climate change thing, every time they have their debates, have you noticed Donald Trump's approval ratings go up? You know, so it's like, if only they could be on TV every night. And I think what's most disturbing, look, I'm not an especially partisan person. I am a Republican, but I'm not oftentimes happy with what Republicans do in Washington. So I am not a rah-rah Republican. What disturbs me is what I'm hearing from the Democrats. It really is an agenda of, you know, socialism is actually not the right word, in my opinion, to describe where the Democrats are. The Democrats today are not socialists. They are statists. They're authoritarians. They want to tell you what you can do. And, you know, I'm a libertarian. I just believe, look, if I'm not hurting someone else, or I'm not hurting their, if you don't hurt another person or their property, you should pretty much be able to do what you want to do. And yet, you know, I listen to the Democrats. They want to, and just listen, like on climate change, they want to tell you what car, kind of car you can drive. They want to say that you can't use airplanes. They want to tell you what kind of straws you can use, what kind of light bulbs you can put in your house, your personal behavior, your diet, you know, whether you should be, can eat meat and so on. Now look, maybe you should eat meat, maybe you shouldn't. I mean, some of you probably are vegetarians. I've been trying to cut down on my meat consumption, but that's a decision that every individual should make, right? And one of the things I feel so strongly about, I want to just imprint this in you, is that, because when you're dealing with your colleagues, it's so important to understand this. Freedom is such a precious commodity. You know, we are so fortunate to live in the greatest country on earth, right? We're a flawed country, but we're certainly the greatest country on this planet. And we're a great country because we have freedom, and we respect that. We have a Bill of Rights. I was listening to a Democratic congressman, by the way, the other day, who's the third ranking Democrat in the House of Representatives, who said something really scary. He said, I wonder sometime if the Bill of Rights were brought up for a vote in front of the American people, whether the American people would vote for the Bill of Rights. That's amazing, isn't it, to think about it? A right of free speech, a right of assembly, a right of religion, a right to own, you know, a gun, our rights to, you know, the fact that the federal government should be subservient to the states, all of these rights, your civil protections against the police state and so on, that those are in danger right now from the left. And that's why, that's one of the reasons I wanted to come and talk to you, frankly. I mean, this is a Saturday night, there's a lot of other things I could be doing, but this is a really critically important time. And one of the things that frankly disturbs me about your generation, well, actually the generation that's a little bit older than you, they're so willing to give up their rights. And what I would say to you is, you know, we've had millions and millions of Americans who have died, given their right, you know, their sacred honor and their fortunes to protect our freedoms, and don't give them up. Don't give them up to politicians. And so I want to talk a little bit about what's going on with the economy. And then, as I said, I want to save some time at the end and explain kind of why is it that things are good. Because look, we have a very strong economy right now. There's no question about it. We have 7.5 million more jobs today than people to fill them. Think about that. I mean, just let that idea sink in. There are 7.5 million jobs that are open, that are unfilled, that employers can't find people to fill, to fill those jobs. That's never happened before in the history of the United States. When I graduated from college in the early 1980s, even with a college degree, you couldn't even get a job as a burger flipper with the college. That's how bad the economy was. Today, we have 7.5 million open jobs. There's only 6 million unemployed people in the United States today. There's only 6 million people looking for a job who can't find one. So I'm not too good at math, but I think I can do this in my head. If there's 7.5 million open jobs and there's 6 million people looking for a job, that means even if we put every single American who's looking for a job into a job, we'd still have 1.5 million jobs left over. That's pretty amazing, isn't it? Never happened before in the history of the United States. That's the sign of a pretty strong economy. And it didn't happen by accident. I do think it happened because of policies we put in place under Donald Trump that have turned around the economy in a major way. So the first thing I want to discuss with you is the national debt. How many of you would say that you're concerned about our $22 trillion national debt? I mean, almost every hand should go up in this room because it is a great crisis. And you're looking at what you're looking at, this red line shows, here's what happened in the 10 years, George W. Bush's second term and the Obama term. Look at that. Look at what happened to our national debt. It just went straight up. We increased our national debt more under George W. Bush and Barack Obama than all the previous presidents combined. That's pretty scary, isn't it? And that was a Republican and a Democrat. And when Trump came into office, this was what we were looking at. This was the projection of these massive increases in government spending and government debt. And that's a problem. If the government keeps borrowing and borrowing and borrowing $1 trillion a year, guess what? The joke's on you, because you're the generation that's going to have to pay these debts. And so we're just passing these costs off to your generation. So when you start working, a lot of the tax you're going to pay are just to have to pay off the interest on this debt. And so that's a very scary picture. Now, I'm going to ask you all a question, because I want some audience participation here. You see how the debt goes up and up and up and up over the next 20 years? Who can tell me what the single biggest factor is that's causing those debt numbers to go up? Yeah. What? That's one factor, but it's not the major factor. I mean, you're right. Interest costs are going to go up, but that's not the one. Yes, sir. I can't hear you. Inflation? No, actually, inflation is pretty low right now, and that's the same as interest rates. But no, that's not the biggest problem right now. Yeah. What's that? Government spending, but what spending, ma'am? Yes, exactly. Now, Social Security and Medicare are the drivers, and there's one other one, which is Obamacare, right, and Medicaid. And so what are those programs? Those are programs that provide aid to what group of people? No. What group of people get Social Security and Medicare? Old people, right? Old people. Your grandparents are getting those are programs that you start getting benefits when you turn 65. So we have other programs, you know, that are welfare programs that go to people who aren't working. But the Social Security and Medicare are for people when they retire. And so you've got these enormous, you know, costs of those programs. Now, what's happening demographically in the United States that's going to cause those costs to go up? What generation is retiring now? Baby boomers. I'm a baby boomer. I was born in 1960. Anybody who was born between 1948 and 1964 is a baby boomer. You know how many baby boomers there are? 78 million. There's 78 million. We're the biggest, you know, generation ever. And so that, think about this. 78 million people, and it's already started because 10,000 Americans are retiring every single day. 10,000 Americans are retiring every single day. That's 4 million people a year. It's going to keep happening and happening and happening. Guess what happens when those people retire? Instead of paying taxes and working, now they're going to be collecting all these benefits. What you're looking at, this is the Titanic headed to the iceberg, right? And we know this is going on, and so that's a big problem. We don't have enough workers to fill, you know, to pay for all the costs of these old people. The other thing is the growth. We need faster economic growth, and one of the things that we looked at, by the way, this is one of the charts we showed Donald Trump 4 years ago. We said, this is what we're facing. And he said, well, what do we do about this? And one of the things that Larry Kudlow and I said to Donald Trump is, we got to get the economy growing faster. We got to get more people in jobs. We got to make companies that be more profitable and hire more workers and have people with higher incomes. Because guess what? When people have more jobs, when they earn more, when the corporations do better, when fewer people are on welfare, what happens to tax revenues? They go up or down? They go up, right? If more people are working, they're paying taxes, right? And so it turns out if we can get the economy to grow faster, and then instead of the debt going way up, the debt will go down. And that's one of our biggest aims in the Trump administration, is to get the growth rate, keep it high, so that we see the debt going down, not up. By the way, the other thing, there is something we can do to get more workers into the country to help pay the cost of this, of these high costs. What we have an advantage over every other country in terms of getting workers. How can we do it? Yeah. Immigration. Yeah. We need immigrants. You know, we need immigrants. We need immigrants, but they need to be legal, right? Yeah. But we believe that immigrants are good for the immigrants are great for our country. They have to come legally. They have to come legally. And so we need, you know, Silicon Valley, you go out to Silicon Valley, every third worker in Silicon Valley. We get the brain power, we get the people who work hard, but they have to come in legally. So if we have more workers, we can have more people paying taxes, and we can bring that down. So that's number one. Number two. So the question is always asked about Trump. You know, did he actually turn down around the economy? Because, you know, I'm going to point out some of the policies that Trump put in place. But these are blue-collar jobs. What are the major blue-collar jobs? Manufacturing, construction jobs, mining jobs. Those are three of the major categories of jobs for middle-class Americans, high-paying middle-class jobs that were disappearing. So you can see under Obama, these numbers for construction, manufacturing, and mining were either flat or dramatically falling. Look what happened. Here's where Trump comes in. Look at that. We've created 1.4 million blue-collar jobs since Trump left office. I mean, since Obama left office. I mean, that's a pretty cool chart, isn't it? I mean, you don't think there's a Trump effect here? It's like a U-turn in terms of jobs. This is something I know Trump is especially proud of. But everybody says, oh, Trump just cares about rich people. Nonsense. These aren't rich people who are going into these jobs. These aren't rich people. These are middle-class people who now have jobs that were leaving towns like Erie, Pennsylvania, and Flint, Michigan, and Oshkosh, Wisconsin. They're back, baby. These jobs are back, and that's a result of some of the policies Trump has put in place. The next one I thought I'd show you is, this one I think is so cool. We're really, really proud of the fact that the unemployment rate in the United States is the lowest it has been since the mid-1960s, since Frank Sinatra was still putting out music. I mean, that's an amazing thing. Look at what happened. The blue line is under Obama. Look at what's happened to the black unemployment rate under Trump. It is today the lowest unemployment rate that they've ever recorded at the Labor Department for black Americans. We're proud of that. You know, we're proud of that. Look at the Hispanic unemployment. How many of you are Hispanic in this room? I see. We have the low. Why isn't Donald Trump getting like 70% of the Hispanic vote? Look what he's done for Hispanic workers. Look at that. The lowest Hispanic unemployment rate ever, ever. This is our racist president, right? He's a racist. He's a racist. He's created more jobs for black Americans and Hispanic Americans than ever. It's a ridiculous charge to say that Donald Trump is racist. His policies have benefited minorities more than any other group. What has he done? What has he done to turn around the economy? Well, number one, we've deregulated. We've got the government off the back of businesses. Trump is pro-business. And there's nothing wrong with being pro-business. If you want to help America, you want to help American businesses. You know, my old friend Dick Armey, who was a famous House member, used to say, liberals love jobs. They love to talk about jobs, right? But they hate employers and they hate businesses. You can't be pro-jobs and anti-business. And Trump is pro-business. And when businesses do better, what do? They hire more workers, they pay workers more, they provide more benefits, and that's what's happening. And so look at the reduction in regulations. They've fallen by a third under, it went up under Obama. Trump is cutting back on the regulations. Look, we all want clean air and clean water and safe workplaces and so on, but the regulations were just strangling our businesses and they were benefiting every country that we compete with. They were benefiting, these regulations were benefiting the Chinese and the Germans and the French and the Mexicans, but not the United States. And so that's a big deal. This is one of my favorite Time magazine covers. This is, from last year, Trump, how Trump's cabinet is dismantling government as we know it. Well, hell yes, he's dismantling government as we know it. That's why we elected the guy, right? I mean, come on. This is exactly why people, what was Trump's, can anybody remember what Donald Trump's final argument was to the American people in the final weeks of the campaign? Three words. Remember this one? Drain the swamp. What did that mean? Drain the swamp. get the resources out of Washington. Did you know 3 of the 5 richest counties in the United States of America are in or around Washington, D.C.? That's amazing. How did that happen? I've lived here 30 years. We don't produce anything. All we produce is laws, regulations, lawyers, politicians, rules, and we're getting rich off it at the expense of the rest of the country. What we're trying to do here with deregulation is drain the swamp and bring the money back to the people. The next one, taxes. We did a big tax cut. We're proud of it. We think it's worked really well. We want lower tax rates on American businesses and American workers, because when tax rates fall, people have more of an incentive to work. If I told you I was going to tax you 80% of every dollar you earned, I was going to take 80 cents out of that. Would you work very much? Now, what if I said to you, Angelina? What I said, I'm going to tax you 90%. You know, because Elizabeth Warren wants a 90% tax rate. You're going to work at a 90% tax rate if the government takes 90 cents out of every dollar you earn? I don't think so. Now, what if I say I'm only going to tax you at 15%? You're probably going to, so you see what I'm saying? If the tax rate falls, what is people's incentive to do? To work more. It's a very simple thing. And so here's what we did. We cut tax rates. This is under Reagan. We cut tax rates considerably, and they've remained pretty low. Look at the share of taxes paid by the rich. They went up. Isn't that interesting? So as the tax rate went down, the amount of taxes paid by the rich went up. And that's because people were earning more money. There were more rich people, so they paid more taxes. It was a beautiful thing. Lower taxes, a booming economy, and that's what we did under Trump. This is my favorite quote from history. This is John F. Kennedy. John F. Kennedy, by the way, if John F. Kennedy were alive today, he would be a Republican. There is absolutely no doubt about it. John F. Kennedy was pro-tax cut, he was pro-trade, he was pro-life, he was all the things. Do you think the Democrats would kick him out of the Democratic Party in 1 second with those kind of views? And he was a big tax cutter. And he said this shortly before he was tragically assassinated. It's a paradoxical truth that tax rates are too high and tax revenues are too low, and the soundest way to raise the revenues in the long run is to cut the rates now. Wow. That's a pretty amazing thing for a Democrat. How many Democrats today believe that? Zero. All they want to do is raise rates. They don't want to cut them. And so I love that quote from Kennedy. I wish that more Democrats understood that. This is one of my favorite ones. We showed this to Trump. This was the heart of our tax plan. You see this black line at the top here? This was our tax rate over the last 30 years that we've been charging American business. We've been charging American business a 40% tax rate on their profits. So every dollar of profit they made, they'd have to pay 40 cents of tax. These green pillars, you see how these green pillars are falling every year, down, 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 down? These are the tax rates that have been imposed by all the countries we compete with. So that's Germany and Australia and Mexico and China and France and Italy and all of the countries that we compete with. And you can see what's been happening over the last 30 years. They're cut, 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 every year, down, 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 down. We're up here, they're down here. We showed this to Trump, and we said, Donald, this doesn't work real. We're at 40 and they're at 20. And I remember I said to Trump at that point, I said, this is like a 20% head start program for every country we compete with. Why would we do that? And I remember Larry said, it's almost like what we're doing here is we're imposing a 20% tariff on our own goods and services. That's economic masochism. Why would you do that? Something that stupid. And we advised Trump to cut the rate from 40 to 20% so we'd be in the game, so American companies would not be at a disadvantage. I'll never forget, we said, Donald, we think you should do a 20% business tax rate. And I'll never forget, what he said to us? I want 15. I want 15. He went at a lower rate. We didn't get 20, 15. We did get 20. We're down here. We're back in the game, and now we're sucking capital and jobs from the rest of the world because taxes matter. This idea that this was a big tax cut for big corporations is ridiculous. There's 8.5 million small businesses in the United States. 8.5 million small businesses. Men and women who started their own businesses, and they are the spinal cord of the American economy. We couldn't survive without the entrepreneurship of small business owners. And incidentally, let me just say something as an aside. How many of you, I want to ask you this question. I know you're all, still practically teenagers, and maybe some in your early 20s, but most of you are teenagers. So you don't know what you probably want to do with your life, and I certainly didn't know what I wanted to do with my life when I was a teenager. But I want to ask this question. How many of you aspire to someday starting your own business? Open your raise your hand. Awesome. I wish every hand would go up. Why are you going like this? You don't want to start a business? Yeah. Well, if you really want to serve your fellow man, I always, all these young kids say, oh, I want to do something to help people. I want to join the Peace Corps. Da, da, da. I don't have anything wrong. There's nothing wrong with that kind of thing. But the single most important thing you can do to help your fellow man? Start a business. Start a business and hire people. How many of your parents are small business owners? A lot of them are. And they, how many employees do your parents have?
Zero.
They just work for themselves, or okay. How many? How about you? How many employees does your parent? Yeah. Okay. Okay, so that's like 8 people who've been employed by your parents. That's great. Yeah. How many? 200. That's awesome. I mean, think about the impact that your parents are having on the lives of these 200 people. And that's why, I wish every one of you to think about it. Well, you're still young, but when you graduate from college, think, I want to start my own business. By the way, the great thing about starting your own business, you work for yourself. You don't work for the man. And so, but anyway, we cut our taxes on small business. It had a nice positive impact. I thought I'd show you this one, the top 1%. The evil top 1%. How many times have you heard that 1% don't pay their fair share in taxes? Have you all heard that? Oh, they don't pay their fair share. They're paying no taxes. Look at this. The top 1% today, here's how much the percent of the tax they pay. They pay more than the bottom 90%. 1 out of 100 Americans pay more in federal tax than the bottom 90 out of 100. That's a pretty progressive tax system, wouldn't you say? By the way, the top 50% of Americans pay about 96% of the taxes. 50% pay 90%, 96%, and the bottom 50% pay 4%. This is actually kind of a perfect experiment. Because I want to demonstrate this point. There's about 100 people in this room, maybe a little bit more, but roughly 100 people. So if we paid our, and did you guys have dinner yet? Did you guys have, okay. So let's say that you were going to pay for the dinner that you guys just had the same way that we paid our taxes. The way this would work, I'm gonna stand right here, it's right smack in the middle, okay? So everyone on the left, you're in the top 50% in income, and all of you to my right, you're in the bottom 50% of income, okay? No shifting places, okay? So you're the richest half, and you're the poorest half. And let's say we're gonna pay for that dinner that you just had the same way we pay our federal taxes. What it would mean is the ones over here, you're gonna pay 96% of the cost of the dinner, and you lucky duckies over here are gonna pay 4%. And then this young woman, what's your name?
Michaela
is the richest person in the room. Did you know that? She's the richest person in the room. And so Michaela is gonna pay almost half of the cost of the dinner herself. That sounds fair, right? Is that fair? Come on. It's ridiculous. It's not fair at all. These people pay almost nothing. These people pay the whole freight. We have an extremely progressive tax system. I believe everybody should pay their fair share, but that means everybody should pay something. Here are the statistics. Look at that. The top 1% pay almost 40% of the taxes, and they make, the bottom 50% pay 3%. That's a very progressive tax system, and nobody ever talks about that. Okay, what next? Here's an amazing thing. Under Donald Trump, for the first time in 50 years, the United States of America is producing more oil and gas than we are consuming. For the first time in my lifetime, and certainly in your lifetime, we are now a net exporter of energy. That is an amazing thing, right? That is an amazing thing. It used to be we were importing $200 billion a year of oil and gas from other countries. By the way, what countries were we importing our oil and gas from?
Canada.
Some from Canada, yes.
Saudi Arabia.
What other countries?
Russia.
Middle East, exactly. Venezuela, Iran, Iraq. We do get some from Canada, but not a whole lot from Canada. But think about that. So we're spending $200 billion a year sending money to countries that hate us, right? The Arabs, the Russians, the Venezuelans, and so on. So we're actually arming the people who hated us. Now, thanks to shale oil and gas revolution, look at this. This is the increase in the output, and our imports have gone way down. I love this story. I love this story. It is the story of the American economy, what's happened with shale oil and gas. The technology here is unbelievable. These drillers now go 2 miles deep into the ground. There's a new technology called horizontal drilling where those drills go down and then they can go 2 miles like a spider web in any direction. And that's made our production so great. How many in this room are from either the state of Ohio, Pennsylvania, or West Virginia? Raise your hand. Just a few. Okay. Ohio and Pennsylvania have become the natural gas center of the universe. We are producing massive amounts of natural gas in Ohio and Pennsylvania. We never used to produce it, and that's because of these new technologies. Did you see the other day, I think it was Bernie Sanders said, if I'm president, I'm going to outlaw, I'm going to outlaw fracking. Fracking is a technology that allows us to crack through the shale rock to get at this massive amount of oil and gas. He wants to eliminate that. That'd be like saying, let's eliminate a cure for cancer. I mean, it's a pretty dumb idea. It would completely paralyze our economy if we did that. Now look at this one. I love this. So is there anybody here from New York? Wow, not a single person in this room from New York. Oh, who is it? You. Okay, I don't want to pick on you, but I'm sorry if you live in New York because you got a lot of bad politicians in New York. So this is Ohio. This is the what we call the shale, the Marcellus Shale, which is a massive pool of natural gas, probably the biggest pool of natural gas in the entire planet. And you can see these red and green and blue dots, those are the wells that have been drilled. And so you can see there's a massive number of them in Ohio, massive number of them in West Virginia. And this is Pennsylvania. Who's from Pennsylvania? Yeah. So Pennsylvania, you're getting rich off of this stuff, right? And what's really interesting, so in New York, the liberals in New York decided they're not going to allow any oil and gas production because they hate fossil fuels, right? So no, we're not going to do it. We're not going to have any of this. No, we're too good. We're going to use solar power and so on. And so remember how I described that the horizontal drilling, they drill down and then the drills can go like 2 miles in any direction. So do you see how all of the wells are on the Pennsylvania-New York border on the Pennsylvania side? You know what they're doing in Pennsylvania? They're drilling down and they're going under New York and they're taking out all their oil and gas. I mean, is that a wonderful thing? Capitalism is a great, great thing. So New York has none of the jobs and Pennsylvania gets all of the jobs. By the way, this is a tragedy because the people up here in upstate New York, these are poor areas. They would love to have those jobs. They're high paying jobs. The truckers in these areas make $100,000 a year, but they're not going to allow it. So all the jobs are in Pennsylvania. It's the reason that Pennsylvania is going to go for Trump. That means cheaper. The fact that we have more energy means that the price of gasoline and things goes down. Here's the increase in our oil and gas production over the last 12 years. Here's renewables. Renewables are fine, but let me just, you're practically adults, so I can say that I can say something to you that Elizabeth Warren and Bernie Sanders and, Joe Biden and Kamala Harris, they don't get this, right? But I think you can get it. We have a $20 trillion industrial economy. We produce things like cars and steel and technology and manufactured items, all this amazing stuff. You can't produce $20 trillion of goods and services with windmills. It's just the stupidest thing I've ever heard. It's just not going to happen. We only get 4 or 5% of our energy from wind and solar. You're not going to replace our oil and gas and coal. You're just not going to. And if you do, you'll completely cripple the American economy. And this is, by the way, with all the subsidies we provide for these. And then I'll show you one that I think is really kind of fun. By the way, people say, oh, no, God, we can't produce oil and gas. We can't produce coal. We're going to pollute the environment. These are terrible for the environment. Wait a minute. Even as these are the trends in our air quality in the United States. Every single city in the United States is cleaner today than it was 50, 100 years ago. Most people, I bet most of your classmates, if you ask them, do you think the air is cleaner today than it was 50 years ago? People say, oh, 50 years ago, the air and water was so much cleaner than it is today. That's nonsense. All we've been doing is cleaning up the air and the water. Look at the lead in the air, the carbon monoxide, all these things that can cause asthma and other diseases and can kill you. We've reduced those even as we're producing more output and we're producing more energy. So the point is, free market economics can create a safe and reliable environment. And by the way, what countries have the worst environmental protection? Well, the old Soviet Union, North Korea, Cuba, Venezuela, those are the big polluters. Socialist countries pollute, free market countries don't. Next. Oh, I love this one. So, do you know how Trump, how many of you have heard of something called the Paris Climate Accord? Have you all heard of that? This is this deal that Obama got that all these countries are going to agree, they're going to sign this treaty, they're all going to agree to cut their carbon emissions, right, so that we don't, you know, all have a big fireball on the planet Earth. And so it's about 3 years old now. And by the way, I think the single best thing that Donald Trump did for our country and our economy was pulling the United States out of the anti-American Paris Climate Accord. It was a horrible deal for the United States. And so everybody, oh my God, Trump doesn't care about the economy. No, Trump recognized that none of these countries are going to honor the treaty. And look, these are all the countries. None of them are coming anywhere close to meeting their climate, their carbon emission reduction. In fact, not a single one of them out of 35 largest countries, none of them have reduced their carbon emissions like they promised they would. Now, here's the kicker on this. I will give a signed copy of my book to anybody who can tell me the answer to this question. Of all the largest countries in the world, the 35 largest countries in the world, in the last 2 years, what country do you think has reduced its carbon emissions the most? Gosh, a lot of hands have gone. If you know it, shout it out. United States of America. United States of America. That, by the way, many of you are probably stunned by that, right? Gosh, how could we have reduced our carbon emissions? We're not part of this stupid Paris Climate Accord thing. And they ask, what is, now I'll give another signed copy to someone who can tell me how it is that we're reducing our carbon emissions. Yes, sir. Well, yeah, but that's not exactly, I mean, that's part of it. Who said that? Yeah, what do you mean by that? So hold on, when you said fracking, right? When we frack, what do we get? Yes, bingo. Will you make sure I get this gentleman a signed copy of the book? Okay, you're exactly right, sir. So when we frack, we get two things, actually. We get oil and we get natural gas. And it turns out that natural gas, we're producing more and more natural gas all the time, right? And natural gas is a wonder fuel. Think about it. It's cheap, it's abundant, it's reliable, it's made in America, and it's clean burning. It's everything that you would want in a fuel. And it's the reason that we're reducing our carbon emissions, because we're using more natural gas. That's why you get the book. And here's the thing. The left wants to get rid of natural gas. Why? Why would they want to get rid of natural gas? It actually cleans up the environment, and they're against that. Think about this. The only four forms of electric power production the left are in favor of are the two that don't work, wind and solar power. If it does work, they're against it. And if it doesn't work, they're for it. By the way, there is one form of energy that produces, that is a very, very abundant, very, very much abundance in its supply. We've been using it for 50 years, and it emits zero greenhouse gases. What is that, sir? Nuclear. But you know what? The left hates nuclear power too. So the two sources of energy that are going to most reduce our carbon, our greenhouse gas emissions, are nuclear power and natural gas, and they don't want to use those. I mean, that tells you they have a broader, agenda here, and that agenda is to shut down the capitalist system. This is not about cleaning the environment. It's about getting people out of their cars, riding their bikes, using mass transit, and controlling their lives. And that's not something your generation, look, it's not going to affect me, it's going to affect your generation. If you let these climate change crazies run our economy, they're going to drive it right over a cliff, and we're going to be a lot poorer for it. So that's cool. I'm going to kind of skip on this. I want to make a couple more points, and then I want to just take your questions, because I really learn a lot from hearing from you. This is really important. So this is the, there's something called the inflation index. We call that the consumer price index. And that's the measure of how much inflation. Who was it that brought up inflation? One of you mentioned inflation earlier. Yeah. So inflation is a big deal, right? Because it's the rise in prices of the things that we buy. So if a house costs, X one day and X plus 10% next year, then you've got a 10% inflation. And so we do it, what we looked at was, which industries over the last 20 years have had the most inflation? Where are costs rising the most and where are they falling? And this is pretty interesting. This is cars, automobiles, and trucks, clothing and textiles, furniture down, computers down, computer software down, toys down. The kinds of things that you buy at Walmart and stuff, they're actually falling in price. which is amazing. I mean, a car today costs less than it did 20 years ago, and today's cars are a lot better in the quality than they were 20 years ago. So this is the magic of the free market system, right? We produce more and more things, and when we produce more of these things, their prices fall. It's wonderful. People can afford more. You know, in most countries in the world, poor people can't afford cars. Virtually all poor people in the United States have cars because the cost of these things fall. And so you can see these are some of the other things. And then look at the two on the far left there. I don't know if you can read that. The two industries where prices have risen the most over the last 20 and 25 years. Education and healthcare. What do those two have in common? Shout it out.
Government.
Government, right? These are the two industries that are most run by government, education and healthcare. Now, I would submit to you that these are probably our two most important industries, right? Our education, I mean, we can't have a productive society if people get a lousy education, right? I mean, education is really damn important to our economy. We've got to make sure we get the best schools in the world. And then healthcare. I mean, healthcare is about how long you're going to live and the quality of your life and, you know, curing disease and all these things. That's pretty darn important too, right? So education and healthcare, I would say, are the two most important industries. And yet, you know, look what's happening to the prices. Now, when I ask my friends, you know, who are liberals, because I do have some liberal friends, I say, why do we have the government play such a big role in education and healthcare? You know what they say? To make it more affordable. They're doing a wonderful job of it, aren't they? You know, it's amazing. This is government is ruining our education. It's ruining our healthcare system. That's why Medicare for All is the stupidest idea I've ever heard. I mean, if you had Bernie Sanders president and everybody gets Medicare and everything's going to be free, do you know how expensive that's going to be? I mean, it's going to bankrupt our country. Milton Friedman, how many of you know have heard of Milton Friedman? Almost all of you. I mean, he's the greatest economist of the 20th century. He believed in the free enterprise system. Please buy his book, Free to Choose. It's a great, great book. But Milton Friedman was very famous for saying something that is the heart of economics. Milton Friedman is the one who said, there ain't no such thing as a free lunch. What did he mean by that? There ain't no such thing as a free lunch. If the government gives you something, somebody has to pay for it, right? It may not be the person who's getting free lunch, but somebody has to pay for that lunch. If the government gives a car to somebody, somebody has to pay for the car. If the government gives health care for somebody, somebody's going to have to pay for it. And that's going to be the taxpayers, and taxes are going to go way up, and you're going to get reduced quality of care. We do not, this is probably one of the most urgent issues other than the climate change crazies. We cannot allow the government to take over our health care system. It will destroy the quality of care. I can't tell you. How many of you are immigrants who came from another country, were born in? There's three or four of you who were born in other countries. When I talk to, you know, students all over the country, it's always the foreigners, you know, people who were born in a foreign country, you know, either, you know, Russia or Poland or Venezuela, these other, you know, Cubans. And they always come up to me and they say, why is it that our politicians and these Americans want more socialism? And these kids always say, I came to this country and my parents came to this country to get away from socialism, to get to freedom. And, you know, there's too many young people who think socialism is the way to go. It is not the way to go. And this is a good example. By the way, education, you know, college. I just sent my son off to Villanova, which is in Pennsylvania. Anybody want to guess what the all-in cost of room, board, and tuition is at Villanova now? $70,000 a year. I mean, that's like thievery. It's stealing. How do these universities get away with that? I'd rather just give my son $250,000 and let him go play computer games for 4 years. He'd probably be better off. So, I mean, the point is, these things are really ridiculous. These costs can fall considerably, but not by government, by letting the free enterprise system. And then I'm going to end on this, and then I'll take your questions. This is, you know, I'm always asked, how can I prove in one picture the superiority of free market capitalism versus, I don't know if you call it socialism or authoritarianism or Maoism or Stalinism or Nazism or Bernie Sandersism, whatever you want to call these things. They're all the same thing. They're the government control of the economy. So how do we know that free markets are better than a government control of the economy? And my favorite way to look at this is by comparing North Korea and South Korea. Now, how many of you have seen this picture before? I bet a lot of you have. Maybe half of you have seen it. This is old. This is about 15 years old. It's not new, but it hasn't changed. And what you're looking, for those of you who've never seen this before, you see, this is a peninsula, Korea. It was once, you know, for millennials, it was one big country. And then 75 years or so ago, they put a line between the two of them. And North Korea, you know, became communist, and South Korea became a free market economy. And So this was a picture taken about 15 years ago. What it is, what you're looking at, is a satellite photo taken over Korea of at night, and the white spots are the areas where there's light and where there's heat, and the dark spots are areas that are in the dark. And look, you know, this what city is this? Seoul. This is Seoul, South Korea. It's a giant. It's right on the demilitarized zone. And look at that. I mean, Seoul is like three times bigger than Chicago. It's bustling with activity. It's amazing. It's totally westernized. People are, you know, getting rich there. And you can see all the areas with light in South Korea. And then look at North Korea. Just one little dot there. I think that's Kim Il-sung's castle. I mean, the rest of the place is in the dark. Now, think about that. I mean, how did that happen? 60 years ago, it was all one continent. They had the whole system. It's the perfect experiment, right? Because the, you know, think about this. The Koreans in South Korea and North Korea are the same in every single way. Their geography is the same. Their resources are the same. Their language is the same. Their DNA is the same. Their culture is the same. Their religion is the same. Everything is the same, right, in these two things, except they drew this line and they said, you're going to be communist and we're going to be free, and look at the difference. And yet too many liberals say, hey, we should be more like North Korea. How stupid is that? Really, how stupid? You got to get a medal to be that stupid to say, gee, we should be more like them and us like them. And so, you know, that's my argument, that you are all so privileged in this room, and I'm privileged, that we won the lottery of life. Every one of us won the lottery of life. There's 6-7 billion people on the planet, and there's 300 million Americans. So that means we all had a 1 in 20 shot of being born or having been able to immigrate to this great country. And you know what? You know how we know that this is a great country and capitalism is better than socialism? Guess what? Because everybody in the world wants to come here. They don't want to leave here. I mean, you know, we talk about all these illegal immigrants who want to come into the United States. You know, if I were living in Mexico or some of these countries, I want to come here too, wouldn't you? I mean, so look, they've got to come legally, and we do have to enforce our borders. But I'm certainly glad that we have tens of thousands of people over our border trying to get into the country rather than try to get out of our country. And so this is a great, good country. It was made great by freedom and free market capitalism, and never, 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 never give that up. Okay? Thank you very much. Okay? Now, I'll take some questions. Let's go. Thank you. Thank you so much. Okay. Go. Where are you from? Tell me your name and your state, and then give me your question. We'll try to get through as many of these as we can. Yeah.
Hi, I'm Cameron Arcan. Yep. From California.
Okay.
And from California, and President Trump has made a lot of news recently for putting tariffs on countries like China.
Yep. Yep.
How do tariffs impact the economy?
Good. Okay.
And
good.
Do they interfere with the free
okay.
market?
Okay. I'm glad you asked that, because I was going to get into this, but then I thought maybe nobody's interested, but you're interested, so good. I'm interested in it too. So. You know, when I met with Donald Trump, you know, 4 years ago with my buddy Larry Kudlow, who's now the chief economist for Trump, we sat down with him, and he said at the end of this meeting, you know, he said, I want you and Larry to be my chief economic advisors for the campaign. And we had kind of looked at each other. We said, well, you know, Donald, I liked him. And I said, but we can't be your advisor. We're for free trade. By the way, Milton Friedman, remember I mentioned this, if you're writing down any of this, there's four pillars of prosperity, okay? Write this down. Number one, a sound currency. You know, a currency that holds its value, a good monetary system. We have that with the dollar. Number two, low taxes, right? We have that in the United States. Number three, less regulation, and you know, that doesn't strangle our businesses. And the fourth pillar of prosperity, Cameron, is free trade. It's free trade. Yeah. Look, if you and I trade something, if I've got something you want and you have something I want, and we trade, by definition, we're better off, right? If it's a voluntary exchange, that's the magic of the free enterprise system. People are trading every day, and every single trade makes people better off, or else they wouldn't engage in the trade in the first place. And it's the same thing with countries. If, you know, China wants to bring in stuff to the United States, and we want to buy it at their low prices, and then we want to sell stuff to them, great. You know, it makes both of us richer, right? And so free trade is one of the pillars of prosperity. And so we said to Trump, well, we can't be with you on this because you're for free trade and we're not. And Trump said something very interesting. He said, look, I understand the benefits of free trade, but I want to make sure that we have a level playing field, that the other countries are playing by the rules. And we put this chart together, and lo and behold, he said, just look at the evidence. And we did. And it turns out, especially with respect to China, look at this. China's tariffs are three times higher than ours are. That's not free trade. How's that free trade? By the way, China's stealing $300 billion a year. $300 billion, I didn't say 300 million, $300 billion a year from us in terms of our intellectual property, our copyrights, our patents, our computer software, our intellectual design, our manufacturing designs. They steal that stuff and they don't pay us for it. That's not free trade. If you're stealing from me, Cameron, we can't have a free trade arrangement. We've been in my opinion, this is one man's opinion. I wonder how many of you agree with this. China is no longer a friend. They're no longer an ally. They're an adversary and an enemy. How many of you agree with that? I mean, China is a big, big problem on the intellectual scene. What we want China to do is reduce their tariffs. And we want them to stop stealing from us. And we want them to stop, if you try to do business in China, I'll give you one example. One of my good friends is the Washington representative for Apple Computers. There's Apple stores. You all have Apple stores in your areas and stuff in your shopping malls. So I asked my friend, how many Apple stores are there in China? He said, oh, there's about 150 of them. And then I said, Steve, do you know how many of those are actually owned by Apple? He said, about 10 of them. What that means is, you know what they do in China? They literally just take the Apple insignia, they put it on the door, slap it on the door, say, we're Apple. That's stealing. That'd be like, if you and I said, hey, let's start a McDonald's. We'll just put the golden arches up. We'll call ourselves McDonald's. You can't do that. And they're doing that day after day after day. So I think Trump is fighting the good fight on China. I think that when Trump is going to force China to bring these tariffs down, because frankly, Trump has said, I think he's right about this, if we cannot trade with China, we sneeze. If they can't trade with us, they catch pneumonia. Trump is fighting the good fight here. It is hurting our economy, no question about it. It's slowed down our economy. But the worst thing of all would be for Trump to back down now. We're up against a menace, and Trump has to win. Okay, next question.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Joshua Purnell, also from California.
Uh-huh. Where from?
Castaic, like an hour away from Los Angeles.
I didn't think there were any conservatives in California.
Yeah, me neither.
Okay.
What are your opinions on FDR's New Deal?
The New Deal was one of the great catastrophes of all time. This is something that that when they say, "Oh, we're going to have a new New Deal," it's like a new deal. The last old New Deal was a disaster in the 1930s. I mean, think about this. What happened in the Great Depression? What caused the Great Depression was tariffs. Remember that that gentleman just Cameron was asking me about tariffs. If you get tariffs that are really high, it slows down. It can absolutely grind the international trading system at a halt. That's what happened in 1929 when we passed something called the Smoot-Hawley tariff. Look that up in your history books. The Smoot-Hawley tariffs raised tariffs so high that the global system shut down, and all of a sudden you had this massive depression. And what everything that FDR did in the Depression made it worse. The Great Depression, the New Deal was started to be put in place in 1933. Look at the evidence of what happened to the economy. The economy didn't get better in 1933. It didn't get better in 1934, not in 1935, not in 1936, 1937, 38, 39, 40. What ended the Great Depression? World War II. World War II is what it wasn't the great. It wasn't the New Deal. It wasn't all these stupid government programs. It was World War II, where we put 3 million people in uniforms and sent them overseas, and we had a massive mobilization. And so the New Deal was a catastrophe. We did things like we burned crops in the field, even as people were going hungry, because we thought that would raise prices. I mean, some of the crazy things that happened under the New Deal, we abandoned free market economics, and that's why the Great Depression went on and on and on. We raised taxes, we had high tariffs, we had massive government spending, the debt went up. Everything that FDR did, every single thing that was done in the New Deal was a disaster, and it made the Great Depression deeper. And there's a great book, for those of you who want to read more about this, because you probably have not heard this history, right? Your history books probably say, oh, FDR saved the American economy. No, he didn't. It was 8 years later, we were in a Great Depression. There's a great book by a woman named Amity Schles, and it's called The Forgotten Man. And read that book, and you will understand what I'm saying. Anything else before we call it a day? We're done. All right.
Thank you.
Fight for freedom. Right? Everyone is going to fight for freedom and free enterprise, and you're going to start businesses, and you're going to be successful, and then you're going to support conservative groups that defend the free enterprise system, and argue with your friends that are socialists and tell them socialism sucks. Okay? Thanks. for having me. Good to see you.
Well, we have a book for you to sign for the
school. Got it. Thanks, guys.
All right, let's give him another round of applause. Okay, so this was our final speaker, and I just want to thank each and every one of you for participating in Young America's Foundation's inaugural High School Free Enterprise Leaders Conference. We obviously can't do this event without you, so I want to say thank you. But also, I want to say thanks to the staff. You guys don't realize how much work everyone behind the scenes puts in, so let's give a round of applause for the staff.
Oh, I want to say one quick thing, if I may. Just one quick thing. I want to, if you got any of those questions right, and I promised I would send a signed copy of my book, send me a note, an email, steve.moore@heritage.org, and I will send you a signed copy of Trumponomics, okay? So I think there were five or six of you who had all the questions right. So.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Moore. So I just want to let everyone know about some of the stuff in the audience. We have 15 different unique United States represented, as well as Canada. So we have a large congregation from Canada. Everyone from Canada, put their hands up. All right. Look at all the people from Canada. So.
Wow.
Freedom is more than just in the United States of America. People want to be free around the entire world.
Wow.
And also 70% of you, this is the first time YAF conference. So who's the first time ever attending a YAF conference? This should both look at all these hands.
Wow.
Wow. Awesome. All right. So we hope you guys had a very memorable experience this weekend. And this is just the start of a journey for you, not only at this conference, but when you go back to your schools in your everyday lives. I mean, whether you're homeschooled or you go off to college or trade school or whatever you do, that this is just the beginning. And so we hope you understand the importance of free trade, as you just talked about, and also just the free market to prosperity. If we can be any of assistance to you at any point, high school, college, please let us know. As Director Kyle Fairby talked about earlier, that is something the Young Americans Foundation is always happy to do. So you guys are all now also YAF alumni, so always be happy to talk about that. So before we completely conclude, I do have a couple of closing remarks. We're about to be passing out. We have some of our excellent staff members going to be passing out evaluation forms. So before you guys can leave, we need you to fill those out so we can help improve this conference for next year. Also, some students have said they have to leave conference tonight. They're local students. So if you've already told us you're leaving tonight, you need to check out with Brianna. She will be over in the kitchen area. So make sure to check out with her before you leave. And you'll need to turn in your evaluation form to her. Additionally, we have already set up schedules for everyone's flight information. We will have the shuttles to the airport. So when we check your, when we do room checks tonight, we will be making sure that we know everyone's on the same page for what shuttle they will be on if you are flying out. All right. So hope everyone had a great conference.